Welcome to the public information session for the library articles that are going to appear on town meeting on May 5th. We just wanted to take this opportunity to try to educate voters here in the audience and at home so that when you came to town meeting on the 5th, you would be prepared and understood what the two articles that the library is bringing forth mean. So we're just going to walk through the two articles and talk about what voting yes means and what voting no means for each one, and then we're going to open it up to questions. If you don't already have one, we do have a question and answer document that also has the articles. So all the information we're going to talk about here tonight is also in this. It's also on our website. The information to find that is located here as well. So this is our first article, Article 18. Formerly known as Article 20, in case anybody saw some of the advanced materials for this meeting. So the article reads, to see if the town will vote to authorize the use of the site of the current Hooker School located on the westerly half of the existing 2.763 acre lot owned by the town of Hadley for demolition of the existing structure and construction of a proposed new library building, contingent upon the receipt of a library construction grant from the Massachusetts Board of Library Commissioners and the appropriation of local funding of the balance of project costs, or take any action relative thereto. So what this means in common language is that as part of our planning and design work, we worked with the Municipal Building Committee to identify what sites in town we might be able to use to expand our current library or build a new library, since part of our building program revealed that we needed an 11,000 square foot library and our current building could not house us. So that was the site that was identified as being best for the purposes. And so what we're doing is we're asking the town to authorize the use of that site for this particular purpose, contingent upon us being able to get a grant from the Massachusetts Board of Library Commissioners. We'll talk a little bit more about that grant later, but that grant application is due January 2017. So if we are successful and get that, it would pay for approximately 51% of the whole project. And this article is not asking any authorization of money or anything. It's just really allowing us to move forward with the process and apply for the grant in January 2017. So what a yes vote means is that the space that is currently occupied by the Senior Center, Planning Board offices, HPAT, will become the site of the new Hadley Public Library, pending the passing of the next article and the successful receipt of the construction grants. If the town votes no. Yes, you have a question?
Could you introduce the board, please?
Oh, sure. So we have the board scattered about, and we have our architect here with us. So I'm Allison Dante-Vindman. I'm a library trustee, and I'm the chair of the Planning and Design Committee. I will let everyone introduce themselves.
I'm Patrick Perez, the director of the library.
David Westkevitz, a member of the Municipal Buildings Committee and liaison to the Library Committee.
Nate Best, a member of the Library Planning and Design Committee.
This is our architect here.
My name is Phil O'Brien. I'm with Johnson Roberts Associates Architects.
And we have a few others in the audience as well.
You want to do this? Yeah. I'm Al Weinberg. I'm a trustee of the library.
Mark Sullivan. I'm the town's OPM for this project.
Karen Pearley, library trustee.
I'm Molly Keegan, Hadley Select Board Liaison.
Dan Regish with the Municipal Buildings Committee and the Senior Center Design Build Committee.
We have one more trustee hiding in the back.
Library trustee.
Thank you.
And this is not the entire committee. This is only part of the committee.
So we do have the information about the committee. If you look on the back of this, we do have a website, and it has all the committee members listed there. So you can see those of us who actually aren't here tonight. So we went through what a yes vote would mean. A yes vote would simply authorize us to move forward. We have to have this authorization from the town in order to have any sort of chance at having a successful grant application. So that's That's what a yes would mean. If it is a no, it would mean, first of all, that we'd pass over Article 19, because there's no use in voting for Article 19 if 18 has not been authorized. If we voted no, the Library Planning and Design Committee would then have to try to find an alternate site to put the library, which would also mean that our architects would have to then design us a new building that would fit with that site, since this building is obviously made for that site that we currently have. So if it does come to this, we would work on this, and we would be bringing a new site to the town at fall town meeting. That will be the plan if we voted, if the town voted no for this article. Does anyone have any questions? This is not an authorization of money. This voting yes for this does not affect the tax rate at all right now.
I do have a question.
Yes.
I guess this goes in the category of frequently asked questions of me. There are some people in town who have asked why we did not consider putting this on the former site of the old gym.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's proximate to Hopkins Academy, it seems like it would be a very logical place to put a new library, you know, especially to promote cooperation with the schools and programming and the like. So I know this is a question that came up during this process. I'm wondering if somebody could speak to that.
Sure, I can start, and then I will let Phil fill in the gaps. So we did consider that. We considered that site. We considered using the former Russell School itself. We considered using our own building and expanding. We also considered putting the a new building in the field behind the former Hooker School. And the site that you're specifically talking about was rejected because it's in the floodplain, and one of the things that would have to be done is to build up the entire site, so the building would be above the level of the floodplain. There were also some concerns about parking and whether or not we could share parking with Hopkins. And I'm not sure if there were any other size considerations for that particular site.
The size considerations that we had, the issues that we had, really were driven by the amount of parking. We could probably squeeze the building on there with the setbacks and so forth. There really wasn't enough room to provide all the parking that you would need in order to meet the zoning bylaw and to comply with the Board of Library Commissioners' recommendations. And so you'd have to do some kind of a shared parking arrangement. And it just starts to get real expensive.
Okay, thank you.
So we did consider it. Any other questions specifically about Article 18? I'm sure other questions will come up as we talk. So can you move article? So we have Article 19, which is the next article. So when we're at town meeting, if Article 18 passes, we will move on to Article 19, which reads, to see if the town will vote to accept the preliminary design for the Hadley Library as presented by architects Johnson Roberts Associates and approved by the Goodman Memorial Library Board of Trustees. And further, vote to authorize the trustees of the Hadley Library to apply for any state funds which might be available to defray all or part of the cost of the design, construction, and equipping of the library project, and to authorize the Library Building Committee and or Select Board and or Library Trustees to accept and expand any such funds when received without further appropriation or take any action in relation thereto. So really what this is allowing us, the Library Trustees and Planning and Design Committee, to put forward the grant application with the design. Part of the requirement of the application is that we do have a site identified and approved by the town, and that we have a design ready to go. So we did bring pictures of the design tonight. They're also available online, and Phil will walk us through that. In case you have detailed questions about the design, but voting yes on this would allow us to go forward for this grant with no impediments. If this is voted no, the architects would have to design a new building, which would require the use of more of our current planning and design grant money, and then we would have to present a new design again in the fall. So there's really two opportunities here to help advance the project: voting yes on 18 and yes on 19. Vote on no on either one would require us to have to regroup and try to come up with a different plan that would be acceptable to the town. All of this is really a result of the planning and design grant that the town voted at town meeting to authorize and match. So we received a $50,000 grant from the MBLC and the town matched with $25,000. So what you're seeing now is really your money at work. This is the design, this is the architect that we hired, the OPM that we hired. We've created the building program and gotten this moving forward. So this is the result of your money at work, and we're really taking it to the next step and hoping to be able to take advantage of the fact that the MBLC is currently in the process of offering a construction grant, which would help defray the cost of this library. So that's yes and no on this article. Does anybody have any specific questions on this? Yes.
I don't know if this would be the right time for this question, but I'm an artist, and mm-hmm. I know a lot of the local libraries have exhibition space.
Mm-hmm.
And I know I did not go online and see the plans, but all that I've read, I have not heard or seen anything about exhibition space.
That's a great question. And yes, and there will be plenty of space. I'll have Phil walk us through the design so everybody can get a look at it overall. We do have currently a little bit of exhibition space in the Goodwin, but it is quite limited. But this design will give us more opportunity to have that type of thing for the community. We will have a community room, so that is rather large. It's available for up to 75 people, so it's larger than this room.
That's not walls.
Pardon?
But that's not walls.
Well, it does have walls, but yes, it won't be all walls. You're right, because there'll be a screen, etc. But we'll also have an expanded lobby space, more space, which we could offer a place. We will not have a sort of dedicated art gallery like some, like Portland has the whole, you know, downstairs where they have the beautiful art gallery. But this is really a conservative design for a town. This is really sort of the minimum that we could plan for and still be qualified for grants, because we are well below the capacity that we should be at for a town this size. So really what we did is really come up with the most conservative plan that we could. But I think I'll let Phil walk you through the design so you can get a little bit of a better idea of how it will look. It'll be much brighter, so I think that any artwork that we have on display will be a lot more visible.
And I'd just like to say, as the director of the library, that we do make a priority now to exhibit local artists in the library, and we will continue to do that in the new space, even if it's not, you know, an entire space dedicated just to the display of art. We will continue to prioritize that.
Okay, could you see that okay? Again, my name is Phil O'Brien. I'm with Johnson Roberts Associates, architects. Johnson Roberts Associates has really been around for about 20 years, and really what we focus on is public work, and the majority of that work is really for public libraries and around Massachusetts and New England. We've done lots and lots of public libraries. We've gone through the grant application process with the Board of Library Commissioners numerous times, and so we feel like we know libraries pretty well, but we'd love to have meetings just like this, because one of the things that we're trying to do is get some feedback from you all about what you think about what we've done, so that we can design a library that's not just a great library kind of in the abstract, but a great library for you all in your community. So I think that's, I'd love to hear whatever you have to say, and if you think of anything else, you could certainly share it with the committee members, and it'll get back to me, because that's really part of the process. At some point, I'm gonna get in my car and drive away, and you know, you're gonna have a design in our library, hopefully, if everything works out great, and we wanna make sure that it works for you. We are in the schematic design, early in the schematic design process. The schematic design is kind of the way it sounds. It's kind of big picture look at the building. And so we are still in the middle of that process, and it will actually continue. If you were to apply for a grant and then get that grant, the schematic design will continue beyond that point, because the grant readers, when they look at your application, one of the things they're gonna be doing is looking at the plans that we submit, and they'll have lots of great feedback and so forth. And so things will change then. And then after the schematic design phase is completed, there's another design phase called design development. And that's when we get into things like the design of the systems and so forth. So how we're going to heat the place, how we're going to air condition the place, where all the lights are going to go, and how many outlets are going to be. Those are the things that I don't know right now, but we have made some assumptions, and I can certainly answer questions relative to that based on what I think, based on that. So just to kind of give you an idea where we are. So this is the site plan, and it's obviously done over an aerial photograph. There's the main drag there, Route 9. There's the existing library building there with kind of a green dotted line around it. We're right now right across the street at the town hall. And you can just kind of see peeking out below here is the outlines of the beginning, the front part of the Hooker School. So this is the sidewalk that runs quite a bit in from the road right now on Middle Street, so that sidewalk stays. And what we try to do is, this is the building right in here. We've kept the driveway that comes in now, the parking that's associated with the library pretty much stays the way it is. And we have a driveway that wraps around the building right now, similar to what it does at the Hooker School. So lots of things are very similar. We're a little bit further back on the site than the parking is right now, but only by 20 feet or so. So the footprint of the building, you can see, sits right in here. It's a single story building, no basement, slab on grade. The idea here is to give you a space that is efficient to build and also efficient to operate. There's a main entrance that comes in off the side. We've got some parking that's associated. Handicap parking is right close to the door, and there's some additional parking around the rear. We tried to line up the front of the building with the front of the existing library so it doesn't intrude into that kind of green space any more than this existing building does, with the exception of this small glass reading room, and I'll show you what that might look like in a moment. This you can probably actually see kind of peeking up down there. Okay. Entrance in at the rear here, and emergency exits. There's a potential here off of the children's department, which is the rear of the building, to have a little outdoor space that's associated with that as well. On a nice day like today, you might be able to take the kids outside, read a story. One of the things we also find with our libraries is that even when you're closed, there's folks that drive in, folks from out of town will come and park in your parking lot and use your Wi-Fi if you leave running on the weekends. Because that's one of those things that public libraries afford. It's not just a place where people come to get a book. There's lots of different things at the library now, and that the library does. And that's, we're really trying to make sure when we do a plan like this that there's really something for everyone there. This is one of the reasons we love designing libraries, is there's really a space in this building for everybody in town. And it's there's not a lot of municipal buildings that really can say that. This is like the public park. Everybody is welcome here, and we're trying to make sure that there's something for everyone here. And so hearing your comment, for example, about places to display artwork, that's terrific. That's just the kind of thing that we'd like to hear, and I'll point that out as we go through. So here's the plan. The orientation is pretty much the same as the site plan. So off of the driveway, which runs along in here, you come in through the main entrance. The main entrance lobby has a double set of doors, and from the lobby space, you can get directly into this meeting room. This is a multi-purpose room that's quite a bit larger than this room. It holds about 70 people, and there's lots of wall space in here, as well as windows to let some natural light in here. And this will be set up with different types of lighting, so you can have different types of meetings in there. If you needed to light the front of the room while the rest of the room was seated, for example, or if you needed to do slides, we're trying to make this room as flexible as possible. We typically would also do a room like this with our art hanging hardware on the walls and so forth, so that you don't have to poke holes in the walls in order to be able to accommodate that. But what I will point out is that this inner door right here can be shut down in the evening and off hours so that the rest of the library can be secured, and you can still get into the lobby space and access this large meeting room when the rest of the library is closed. Mm-hmm. Also directly off of this lobby is a drinking fountain, toilet rooms. There's a little kitchenette that's associated with this room, and a storage room for things like tables and chairs and so forth that can stack up in there. So it really is a kind of a zone in the front part of the building that can operate even when the rest of the library is closed, have a meeting like this while everything is secure. If you make your way through into this space, you're greeted in the center by a circulation desk. This is kind of the thing that's tucked over on the left-hand side when you come into the library now. We've got it located in a central location that you can see when you first walk in, and maybe more importantly from a security point of view is when you're leaving, everybody has to walk by the desk so that it reminds folks that you need to check out. It's pretty much the way you're set up now. It's pretty typical. The center space right here is all low furnishings, tables, chairs, comfortable seating, computers, new books and AV materials, display, self-checkout potentials right here, soft seating. So the idea of this space right here is really we see as kind of the living room of the community. You can kind of see from one end to the other over all the stuff that's low, and then we've taken all those book stacks and we've tucked them off to the side. So you have easy access to the book stacks from anywhere in this reading area in the adults department.
but it's easy to kind of see what's going on in this central space. This little guy is that space that I pointed out that kind of sticks out into the front lawn, and I'll show you what that looks like on the outside a little bit. We tried to glaze that. Got some lots of nice soft seating in there, places where you can have a good read. Periodicals are in this room. And again, that's just a nice place to kind of go and catch up with your friends or read something right in here. Right off to the right-hand side, we've got a set of double doors here and a glazed wall. This set of double doors is designed so that it will fold right open and you can leave them open during the day. And that gets you access into the children's department. And so if children's gets a little rambunctious after school, for example, you can shut those doors down and the rest of the library stays quiet. But again, just trying to make that flexible. We've got spaces in here for younger kids and for older kids. We've got another desk position in here in case it gets busy. If somebody wants to kind of sit in that desk and kind of keep an eye on what's going on, just want to make sure that that's taken care of. We've got a children's story room here. And this is, again, is another multi-purpose room that can be used for a variety of things, from reading a story to doing a craft project. And the things are set at kid height rather than having the kids having to try to crawl up on adult-sized furniture. It's got a little counter with a sink in it and some storage cabinets and so forth, just again to try to make it as flexible as possible, and a door that might take you outside to that green area in the back. It's got its own toilet so that the kids don't have to leave this room in order to go use the facilities, so that their parents can kind of keep an eye on them and see what's going on. There's a small office there for the children's department. Mechanical spaces at the rear of the building. There's room for the teens. And the tweens, right here in the center of the room, again, glazed on the wall, a glazed wall in the entrance. I got their own books in there, computers for the kids, soft seating and study tables for after school and so forth. We've got a quiet study room in here that could be used for a variety of purposes. Kids can do school projects in there. You can get in there if you need to do some quiet study work. You could have a conference or a meeting in there. There's a variety of different things, and we find that these smaller meeting spaces are becoming more and more popular in the libraries that we're seeing now. We've got a local history room that also will act as another room like that where you could have a conference. It's a little bit bigger than the quiet study room we have here. Right behind the desk, we have the staff work room. There's no door on that at this point. The idea is that on either side of that opening, there's flanking is the books for holds and so forth. And then it's open so that if somebody comes to the desk and there isn't somebody there, somebody from the staff can come out and help them. There's a staff toilet here, a staff room, and the director's office. Did I miss anything? I think I covered it. And then we have a couple of images. These are computer models that we did about what the building might look like. And basically, we're kind of picking up on some of the architecture you have of your existing library in red brick masonry with white trim. We kind of picked up on that. We're a single-story building, so we're obviously not trying to compete with this building. But we are trying to get a building that is visible. It's one of those things that the Board of Library Commissioners will look for. And as an important municipal building, it's also, I think, a good idea to be able to see what's going on in the community. So this is kind of looking across the lawn of the original building, and you can see there's the main entrance. There's that little rail fence that fronts that parking that's really right there at the back of the library right now. And you can see there's that reading room that we have poking out there in the lawn. This is kind of, if you drive into the driveway a little bit further and you kind of look back at the entrance, Middle Street is over in the back here. That's a better look at the entrance, and so you're looking at the children's department, and that's the children's kind of story and program room that's poking out at the rear. Folks see that okay? So the children's department kind of pokes out in the rear back in here. And then you can see these are the windows that look into that larger meeting room that's up on the left in the front. Here's more of a close-up here of that space that sits out in the front lawn. You can see we tried to keep this face right here lined up with the original library building you see right over there. So the masonry faces of these buildings pretty much line up, and then this smaller element kind of sits out in the lawn. And there's lots of glass on it, so when you step out into that space, it's almost like a nice porch, right? We want you to kind of feel like you're stepping right outside. And the idea is we probably have some nice plants and so forth that surround that area. And these windows will operate so you can get out there and have a nice read, catch up with your friends. Okay, that's where we are at this point. We'd love to hear your input.
Phil, question. You mentioned this is what the library might look like. Could you explain how that works and relative to the design through the application process and how bound the town is to this specific design that we're looking at tonight versus what might come out of the the review process.
Sure. Again, the specifics there are that we really are in the kind of middle stages of the schematic design process. And what that really means is we've gone through the process to kind of take the program that was written before we were hired and turn that into a physical building so that we can determine what a building like that might cost, how it might sit, and whether or not it functions. The design of this building might look like this on the outside, and the plan of the building may look something similar to what's shown here. We've done lots and lots of library designs. We've gone through the process a number of times. I think we're 35 applications or something that we've helped different communities on. Not all of those folks have moved ahead and built a library building, but of all the ones that have, there isn't one building that is built that looks exactly like what we turned in to the Board of Library Commissioners in our application. And the reason is because we do lots of libraries, but the Board of Library Commissioners does all the libraries. They've got some really smart folks there, and the grant readers will have some terrific input. And then once we get those things, that feedback back from them, and we're talking about a year or two from now before this thing is going to come back, and you'll before you probably pick this thing up again. And there'll be some different thinking on your part and the part of the committee. And we'll take that all and we'll put that all back into the mix, and we'll finish the schematic design. Some folks may decide that that you know maybe red brick is not the thing that you want to do. Maybe there's ways that you want to change this. Maybe more wall space inside the building is more important than as many windows as we have. Those are the kind of discussions that we could certainly have. And so I think that this is one way that the building might look, but it is not the way or the only way. And we're certainly open to change things where, you know, I think the building looks nice, it's coming along well, but I'm certainly not married to this design, and I don't think anybody here should be completely.
Thanks.
Any other questions about the design itself? Phil, can you put the timeline board up? So he mentioned the time lag between now and when the building would actually start, and how many opportunities there are to sort of revisit this, materials, you know, different areas, etc. So we just wanted to walk you through the timeline a little bit. It is in your frequently asked questions about, you know, when is this all going to happen? So it is in here. So here we are in May 2016, so assuming that everything goes smoothly and Articles 18 and 19 are passed, that would authorize us to start working on the grant application that is due in January 2017. The winners of the grant are announced generally in the July, so it will be July 2017. So if we do get the grants, we would then put together the information on how much we got, how much our award was with the total cost of the project. And then in fall 2017, we would come before town meeting and at that point ask the town to authorize us to accept the grants and fund the remaining part of the project that was not covered either by grants or by the private fundraising capital campaign that's getting underway. So if that passes in fall 2017, we then have work to do to get the design finalized, draw up the construction plans, etc. We are not anticipating that construction would begin until probably spring of 2019, by the time everything, all the pieces came into place. Any questions on the timeline?
Was it explained by the MBLC that certain, depending how you qualify, it could be spring 2019
would
probably be the very earliest. It could most likely be maybe even a year later, depending on where we would fall in that order of people being awarded.
So the MBLC has a certain amount of money to give out every year. They So depending on the size of the project, they will be able to fund, you know, somewhere around 10 for the first year. So they rank everybody's application in order of need and some other factors. So depending on where we fall in the list, so if we're in the top 10, we're likely to get funding for that first year, which would then, as Karen pointed out, be the best case scenario. We'd be breaking ground in spring 2019. But if we were somewhere further down the list, we might be breaking ground in 2020, 2021. Somebody just finished a library from the last grant round, so that was quite a while ago. West Springfield
is doing one right now.
Yep.
We did one in the 2010 grant round that is, they got the grant in 2010, and they started construction on that building 2 weeks ago.
Okay.
So that'll take
right.
about 14 months to finish that project.
Right. So anywhere from 2019 to, you know, sort of add 5 more years to that.
But it's important, excuse me, to clarify that there's one application date for the grant. It's not something that we could just skip and apply for the next year. There's one application every, what, five, six, seven years?
Years, yeah.
So if we miss the opportunity now, we have to wait, you know, 7, maybe more years until the next time that there's a grant. It's just that the state doesn't have all of the money to spend in that first year. They have money to spend year over year, and that's dispersed based on need. So we're probably not the neediest community that would be applying for this grant. So that's why we most likely would not be in the first year of grants. Does that sound accurate?
Yeah, there's a variety of other factors as well, and the Board of Library Commissioners could probably tell you better. One of them is community support.
Mm-hmm.
If you can show great community support, then that factors in. And if you can do that, that's good for you, because if you can get into that first grant round, they will set your grant amount based on a complicated formula that they have. Once they've set that amount, if you get your grant and they have money for you in 2019 or in 2022,
mm-hmm.
that grant amount stays the same. And as construction prices continue to go up, that won't really move. And so the higher you can move yourself up on the list, the better off you'll be. Because with this, there's certain things that we can do. We can include escalation for those costs in your application, but there's a limit to how far we can go. We can't include 10 years of escalation on there, they'll just reject it. But if you put in a certain number of years of escalation and then you can do it quicker than that, you're still going to have that amount that they give you based on that escalation
mm-hmm.
amount. And
so it would end up costing the town less?
It would end up costing you less, yes.
Good question, Karen. Any other questions about the timeline? Molly?
Not so much the timeline, but I guess question for Patrick. Again, another kind of frequently asked question has to do with the ongoing operating costs for the town to move forward with a brand new building like this. Some people have expressed some consternation that means that staffing levels will increase and it might actually be more costly to operate this building. So could you address that?
Sure. That was one of the primary reasons that we felt having a building that was on one floor rather than a building that was on multiple levels. You know, if we had added on to the building that we currently have and it was on multiple floors, that would mean that we have to maintain staffing on multiple floors just for the sake of security. In a small building like this with sight lines that reach from one end of the building to the other, we can have we can maintain a minimum staffing level and still have a secure building. So we would have a building that at times, if necessary, could be staffed by as few as 2 people and still feel that it was secure. So we don't anticipate an increase in staffing costs. And hopefully, you know, energy costs, we don't have figures for that, but we would assume that energy costs would not be significantly higher, even though it's a larger building.
Mm-hmm.
So
it would probably be hard to build a less energy efficient building than the one we have.
We could try.
Why would we?
Right. And that is part of the thing that they look for in the grant application, is that we have at least thought about LEED certification. So whether or not we end up you know, qualifying for LEED certification is a different story, but that is the goal at this point. If we do end up becoming certified, then we are qualified for additional money back from the state, which happens after the grant's awarded, et cetera. But there is an opportunity to get more money back from the state, the more efficient that we are. Any other questions in general? Yes.
I don't know exactly where you're going with this one, but when they break ground, let's say it's going to be, at the Hooker School is where the senior center is now. Mm-hmm. What happens to the senior center?
That's a great question. So ultimately, the town is going to decide what happens with the senior center. Article 11, and we have Article 11 here so that everybody can see it. Article 11, which is also going to be presented to the town, seeks to authorize money to hire an owner's project manager to oversee some of the building work in town, with a priority being given to looking at the feasibility of a new senior center. The senior center does have its own building committee now, so it's sort of starting the process that we've been going through for the past 2 years, coming up with a building program, coming up with a design, we do have some members of that committee here with us, so they are really the experts, and so I'm hopeful that somebody would like to speak to that.
That would be me. Hi, I'm Jane Nevin Smith. I'm chair of the building committee. Good thing seems to happen. So this article comes before the library articles, and that's sort of practical because until the senior center has a new home, the library cannot move us, and the town agrees to that. So, and everybody thinks that we probably are deserving of a new home in terms of the systems that we have or don't have in the current Hooker School. And as the library is on one floor and more conducive, if you have ever been in the Hooker School, you know we don't even have a floor to start on. You're either halfway up or halfway down. So that would help. So what this article says is to see if the town will vote for money that already exists. So there are no taxes involved here. And what that money does is to let us get started as the library committee or program development committee did several years ago, to get our own project manager and to work on purchasing a piece of land that would be appropriate for us to put our building on. The one thing that a lot of people are confused about is that Article 11 and the two articles for the library are related, but they're really unrelated. So that you could vote yes for Article 11 and vote no for the library articles, in which, or the other way around. You could vote no for the senior center, vote yes for the library, but then the library is out in left field. So it's actually a win-win situation for the town to support this at this time in terms of replacing buildings that need help.
Planning for the future.
And we can't tell you how to vote, but we encourage everybody to come to the town meeting and speak your mind. May 5th, 7 o'clock.
If you need a ride.
Yeah, if you need a ride, call the senior center. We're arranging transportation.
Thank you, Jane.
So I just want to add a little bit more about Article 11. Article 11 was brought about because the Municipal Buildings Committee recognized the need for more land in the center of town, because we really didn't have a place to put a senior center or a library or anything like that on existing land, because it's really small and it has currently other purposes. So there isn't a request for a proposal out there right now that's looking for land within a mile of town center, which if we get decent proposals, we would be able to spend the $300,000 and purchase that land. But it's all dependent on people coming forward with what's available out there. Because if they don't, then we would not be able to move forward on that item. So those numbers should have come in already, and we are waiting to hear what's available, and there will be a committee that gets together to look at these proposals and decide what would be best for the town. So That is still happening, should happen, hopefully before town meeting.
Should be next week.
Yeah, so, but that's the only thing I will say about this right now, where we do have the 50,000, the 300,000, we're still waiting on the answer to that question, so.
So we do have another info session next Wednesday, so maybe we'll have additional information by then. Any additional questions from the floor about any topic related to these articles?
I was just gonna say, I don't think you want to open it to anyone.
No.
Allison, I didn't know if you wanted to talk about the program itself, how we got to this point. We, you know, evaluated the library, the current library, and looked at the basic needs, and this is what we came up with, and this is why.
Sure.
Yeah, so what we did was, we used sort of well-established and used standards for space analysis when constructing or designing libraries. And what we found was that the current library was less than half of what it should be. And as many people know, the current building has many limitations on what it can be used for, what spaces can be used. So we have a top floor that can't really be used for collections. It's also not accessible. There's no elevator in the building. So even though we have three floors, if you know, only the main floor is currently accessible, and that's only about 1,500 square feet. We also use the basement. That's where the restrooms are. But again, they're not accessible. So they're, you know, they're, it, it's, the building is functionally obsolete by any standard nowadays. And so in putting together the building program, we opted to use the most conservative numbers that we could in order to design a building that we felt would be appropriate for the times and for Hadley, that we were not going to build or design a building that, you know, people would question, why are you building such a huge building? I mean, this has happened in other communities, that there's been, you know, more building than was felt was appropriate for the town, and then it has become controversial. So we tended to err on the side of building something that was efficient efficient. That was the bottom line. Minimally adequate. I mean, I think it's going to be very adequate compared to what we have now. If you come to the library and you know the conditions that we work under now, this is a huge, huge improvement. Leaps and bounds ahead of what we're working with now. Minimally adequate, I think we'd be happy to get minimally adequate. Is there anything else about how we formulated this that we should mention? I can't say.
Well, some of this came from the community survey as well. So as part of our work, we did put out a survey to the community. Mm-hmm. We asked them about different aspects of the library that they were looking for, not looking for, where they would like it to be located. So it was an overwhelming response that folks felt that the library should remain in the center of town. So that is why when Molly asked about the different sites we considered, so when we knew that the residents overwhelmingly wanted us to remain in the center of town, we went to the Municipal Building Committee and we said, we are looking for something that would fit an 11,000 square foot library in the center of town. What are our options? And that's sort of how we started. We also asked about different program areas. That's where we got, again, sort of an overwhelming response about wanting community space, which is very typical now in almost any modern library that you walk into. So we did include a sort of, you know, it's big for Hadley, but really a moderately sized community space that can be used after hours by any members of the community. So that is another design element that we added as a result. As well as having a separate space for children and teens. Individually, residents did mention the need to have some space for the teens, which up until this point had been relatively underserved. So the current Goodwin has sort of redesigned some of the space in the basement so the teens would have not their completely own space, but it is much more welcoming for teens now. So we're not just waiting to get this new library to try to make some of these things happen. We have tried to work on some of the program ideas that we could do. You know, folks wanted more programming, more books, all that type of thing. So we're doing what we can now with the facility that we have. Patrick's staff is amazing with working with what we have, but yes, this would be a big improvement for the town.
And also I might comment that the design is meant to be for the next 20 years when you took all the data and survey and put it into this program as part of the grant you needed to. I think 20 years out, we don't know exactly what the library is going to be in 20 years, but this design has that flexibility that certain rooms could be changed around or moved so that it could address the times and the trends of a library, and has a little room to extend out if it ever had to be added on after 20 years.
That's right. We assume it'll last, you know, it'll be here 100 years from now. Somebody will be talking about this again. But yes, one of the requirements of the grant was that you needed to design going with the population projections for 20 years out and show that you had expansion space in case, you know, there was a giant boom in population and we needed to grow it again.
One thing the public should know also is the we had asked the architect to look at several sites, not just the one that we've chosen. And basically came back with a not as conducive in those locations, one being Russell School, one being the current library, and then the backfield as a possibility, backfield to the Hooker School, and also the site that was chosen finally. But they are all feasible in some way or other, but they have a very high cost factor to go with it. So that was taken into account. So this is why we ended up with this site ultimately. So.
Jane, I'd like to just put in a plug. The Senior Center Building Committee is now in the same stage you were 2 years ago, surveying the community. Given the way things are moving, we don't have quite as much time. So next Thursday, the 28th, from 1 to 3, there will be a community forum for anyone who would like to have input on what is needed in a senior center or what they would like their new senior center to do. Please come to the Council on Aging. We look forward to seeing you and hearing from you. If you need a ride, call.
So I'm just going to quickly scan through some of these. Oh, sorry. Yes.
I don't know whether this was already discussed, but what's going to happen to the old library building?
So again, this is going to be up to the town to decide what the building is going to be. There's no plans to demolish it, for example. But the Municipal Building Committee, which is in charge of all of our buildings, is taking a look to see what are the possible uses of it. I'll ask, let Dave speak to that because they have been tossing a few ideas around.
Well, first of all, we're not necessarily in charge of all the buildings. We are only coming up with suggestions of what can be done with the buildings. I mean, that's our task. It's not to tell people what to do with them. Just make suggestions based on our evaluations. Currently, there isn't any specific use for the existing library, but that can be any number of things. It could even be a cultural center. It could be office space for one of the departments that doesn't have office space. There's a number of things that could be done, but it really is going to depend on how we progress. If we find that there's a need for another department after we decide where the library is going or the senior center is going, and then maybe that's where they go. You know, we really don't know, and it's you know, we certainly don't want to tear down the building at this point. And that's that will, like Allison said, will be up to the town ultimately, but. We are open to suggestions too if anybody has any ideas out there, because we are just a board of seven that are trying to decide this for this town, so you know, we can't think of everything.
And Dave, one thing to add to that that's important is that interestingly, the Goodwin Memorial is probably the best maintained building in town of the town-owned buildings, so that's actually the good news.
because to the extent you want to repurpose a building, the trustees have done a very good job maintaining and keeping the good one as up to date as possible, you know, without crossing a threshold for some very significant expenditures in terms of, you know, making it ADA, fully ADA compliant with elevator service and the like. So I think if we had to repurpose a building, it would be a good challenge to have with that one on the corner for a variety of reasons. I would hope that would meet some level of success.
And as the Municipal Buildings Committee, I'd like to echo what Molly just said, is when we first started out this process 2 years ago, we identified the library as being the best kept building out there. So it kind of was off our radar. We didn't really understand the needs of the library at the time, so we started looking at the other buildings, which are very obviously in need of some help. So that became our focus. So just along that process, I think we kind of dismissed the library for a little bit, and then they simultaneously have been moving forward. So this is why we're in this situation right now. We're a little bit ahead of the cart, but we'll try to work it out best we can.
Right, I think because of the timeline of the grant opportunity to be due in January 2017, it sort of has put us ahead as a catalyst to get the rest of the community involved with the full planning for a senior center, park and recreation, needing a space, the HVAC maybe needing a different space. And I know the Municipal Building Committee has done a great job asking those departments what they need so that there can be appropriate space for everybody. And since no new buildings have been built for 20 years, and some buildings are needing help, this is a good opportunity to plan for the whole town. And it's wonderful that the senior center, the COA, is has a committee now, and that can start thinking about what they really need. And I'm thinking, I'm in my 50s, if you can believe it, and I'm gonna be the one going to that senior center, you know, 4 years from now. So I think I would encourage people in my age to be active in that role as well.
And I just want to echo what Karen said. This is truly a catalyst because as Municipal Buildings Committee, we have been looking at the different buildings of what direction should we go in. And we could start just about anywhere, but this has certainly been putting it out front. And so now we will try to work with this, as I said, so.
And I know a lot of folks have said, well, we don't know how to vote because we haven't seen the whole plan for the whole town of which buildings are gonna go where, who's gonna build what when. And from our perspective, we agree. We would have loved to have the whole town have a plan and say, this is exactly where you should build. It would have made our job a lot easier. But the reality is, we felt that it was fiscally irresponsible not to try to pursue this grant opportunity. And if we don't pursue it in 2017, we are not sure when it will come up again or if it will come up again. If it is, it's likely not to come up again for at least 7 years. And we'd have to go through this whole planning and design process again, apply for a planning and design grant, redesign, because all of this will have then been obsolete. So we agree, it would have been great to have a plan, but it's still also good to have free money.
Yeah, and there's time to do some of this, or if not most of this planning, before we need to break ground.
That's right.
And this will hopefully, you know, spur that to completion.
That's right. It seems like a lot of progress has been made just in the past few years. So another 3 years will have gotten us that much farther down the road. And really, that's what voting for these articles, voting yes on these two articles is really saying, yes, take the ball and run it farther down the field. And there's always an opportunity for the town to say later, we can't actually afford that, or this doesn't fit with this plan that we have now. But in the meantime, allowing us to proceed and getting us in line for the grants is really what these two articles are all about.
Have you thought about putting solar panels on this design?
Yep, so that's part of the LEED certification conversation, and we're definitely looking at all those types of how can we use alternative energy sources, how can we use the most efficient materials to build, definitely.
Right.
So as we get further in the design, what did you call it, the design?
Design development.
The design development process, that's when we'll be having those kinds of conversations in conjunction with the Municipal Building Committee as to what they would like to see for the overall buildings in town. But yes, it's definitely come up a number of times.
I mean, one thing we would like to see is low maintenance, and that's one thing that some of our other buildings do not have right now. So anything that we do in this town, we're hoping to make it last a little longer.
Yeah.
Our public safety building is only 20 years old and it already has issues, and just because of choices that were made then. So we're hoping to not have that happen again.
And during that next phase, there'd be forums and opportunities for community to come and give their suggestions or ask questions to get the input. Right, it was saying earlier.
So I did glance through all of the FAQs that we have to make sure that we had answered all of them, in addition to the questions that you've also brought up. And really the only one that we hadn't addressed, and I will let Patrick take this, is how many people even use the library? Because that's another question that we get asked.
That's a great question. So in the last year, we had 17,000 patron visits, which is more than the year before, more than the year before that. We have seen a steady increase in usage of the library, and part of that is due to the fact that we are now members of CWMARS. So for a long time, Hadley residents were, even though we were a certified library, a lot of people were using the libraries in the neighboring communities because they were a more full-service environment. And now that we are also a full-service library, people are coming back and the usage is going up. So and also in terms of circulation, last year we circulated 46,000 items. And again, those numbers are up year over year, so that's very exciting for us. But as we become more successful, we're more challenged in terms of the service that we provide. And I think that the trustees were farsighted in the sense of applying for this grant, the planning and design grant, when they did, because they could see the limitations in the building that we had. And until you actually get the grant, go through the process, analyze the space to figure out what it is that you need, you don't know. And this has been a very rigorous process that we've been undertaking for the last 2 years. So, a lot of time, a lot of thought has gone into this, and the decisions that have been made were not arbitrary. They were very well thought out. And so this is not the end result, but this is where we are now. And I'm personally very proud of what we've done as a group, because it's been a very, I think, inclusive and transparent process for the town. So.
And all of this information is on the website, so our building program, there's a hard copy of the building program at the library if anybody wants to see all the nitty-gritty details, results of the community survey, it's all up there. So if anybody has any additional burning questions that they might want to review after now, we also have an email address up there, so we do take questions and get back to folks.
And that includes, by phone, in person, anytime that people have questions, we welcome them at any time.
Right. And we are having sort of a regular, to keep people updated on how the process is going, we're sending out regular emails, and Maureen back there has cards that if you haven't left your email and name already and you would like to be on the list, please feel free to take one and fill it out. There are no more questions. I'll thank you for coming. We have a member of our capital campaign committee in the audience who would like to say a few words about that.
I'm not sure how much of the whole process I could speak to, but when I heard that there was this new process, I thought, I used to make raffle quilts for the Waldorf School when my daughter was there. Do you guys want a raffle quilt to help raise money and awareness? So it's done. We're looking for somebody to actually head up the raffle, like to put together the packets, to recruit reliable ticket sellers among individuals in the town and also local businesses. And, design the tickets, I guess, because every time that you go to sell a raffle ticket, it's an opportunity to tell somebody about this fantastic plan for this new library that I can't wait to go to.
Turn it to the other side?
Yeah, this is the back. The Friends of the Library helped pay for the batting in the back, which was really helpful. So
this will be on display at the library once we have the details of the raffle worked out. So I know a lot of people have already expressed interest in being able to buy raffle tickets. Yeah,
they'll be a dollar a piece or six for five. So. Yep.
That's beautiful.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That's
beautiful.
Yeah. Anybody else have anything to say? Well, thank you for coming. Hope to see everyone at town meeting.
Yes.